Rev up your engines!
More of a statement. D. Brent says, by the way, guys, that AT-205 is amazing. Thanks, Scotty. I had a valve cover leak. It went away in 2 days after I poured that stuff in. Yeah, I'm not making this stuff up. Okay, you notice, what do you see around me? Nothing but kitty pillow, books that I read and stuff. I'm not sponsored by any of these big companies that's paying me money to tell lies about their products. I've used AT-205 Reseal for decades. I tell people about it. Hey, and it's a polymer. It doesn't jam anything up. It looks like water, but it isn't. It's a polymer. And it will rejuvenate rubber seals. Whatever those guys figured out, it is a fantastic product. And if you don't have to pull your transmission off to change a rear main engine seal, that's going to cost you probably $1,000 and just pouring the stuff in the engine, oh, hey, I'm all for stuff like that. Madman, how come plastic parts on my family's 7-year-old VW crack and break, but the plastic parts on my 11-year-old Toyota don't? Well, you answered your own question there, because the Toyotas are better made. Volkswagen makes crap plastics they always had, and I have more customers over the last couple of decades swear at Volkswagen and say I'll never buy another one because the door handles would break 5 times. All the plastic stuff would break. On the engine, there's plastic sensors. They'd snap off and break, or they'd leak coolant. Volkswagen and just makes crappy plastic parts. It's just the way that it goes, and that's why the stuff breaks, because they make them poor. You can make better plastic. Yes, you can. Now, BMW is another company that makes crappy plastic that just comes apart. Maybe it's a German thing and they don't know how to make plastic. I don't know. Angel Israel 98. Scotty, if you could only have a German car, which German car would you pick? Okay, I get a Mercedes that was made in Germany, because the ones that are made there are more solidly built. The Germans seem to take the job of building cars seriously. And from the ones that my customers have, the ones that are made in Germany, the Deutschland ones, they're much solid, more reliable. They don't break down as much as the ones that are made in other parts of the world. So if I had to, I would get a Mercedes that was made in Deutschland, not one that was made someplace else. And if at all possible, I'd get one with a standard transmission. They are screamers with standard transmission. Steven Ucha. Scotty, is a Toyota Tercel 1994 manual a good car for daily driving? It's $1,300. Okay, it's an old car. It's what? 26 years old. So it's an old car. $1,300 isn't that much for a car these days. If it runs, and it's a standard transmission, as long as the clutch doesn't slip and it works, what the heck? They're notorious for being oil burners and other things. But if it runs good now, you can still get parts for them. It was an economy car. And I had customers that owned them, and they liked them, although they got mad in the end when they started burning a whole bunch of oil. But for that amount of money, hey, if it runs good, doesn't leak all over the place, temperature doesn't overheat when you're out tested, what the heck? It could be a decent car. Benny Boy 10 says, can a whining timing chain tensioner or guide cause the RPMs to bounce or fluctuate while you're driving? More on an idle. That's giving too much slack on the timing. The timing can change a lot while you're idling. When you're actually driving down the road, there's so much tension on it that it really isn't going to make it fluctuate. But if you find that the thing is idling up and down, yeah, the timing is going to change the most when it's idling. When I check for whether they're worn, I get a timing light sticking on and watch it. And if I can see that timing vacillating a lot when it's idling, I know that that's a problem. King Gabby. Hello, Scotty. Sorry if I have a lot of questions. Hey, I don't mind. I'm here to help everybody out. What do you think of a 1983 Toyota Starlet? Okay, 1983 Toyota Starlets were well-made vehicles. They were a bottom-line car. They had no frills. You know, as far as I can remember, they don't even have electric windows. They only have manual crank windows. If you're thinking about buying one and it's still in decent shape, go ahead. Just realize it's an 83. You're talking about, what, 37-year-old car? That's an old car. Don't pay too much for it. You know, it might be a good knock-around car. They were well-made back in the day. When they're that old, you're getting into some problems. I just recently made a video on that. Should you buy a really old car? You might want to watch that. Boris Zakuski. Hey, lads, can I enjoy better gas mileage after changing manual transmission fluid? Unless it's all gunked up, and when you empty it out, it comes out like tar. It isn't really going to make all that much difference. It's a standard transmission. Heck, it's a good idea to change it every 60,000 to 80,000 miles on any vehicle just because fluid gets sturdy. Change it and see what happens. And if you do get a little bit, yeah, then it was really gunked up. Normally, it won't affect it all that much. On automatic transmission, sure, because then they might not shift right. But, I mean, you're shifting a manual transmission by hand, and the fluid doesn't really have all that much to do. But you want to keep it clean anyway. Car junkie, I got a problem with my Chevy Tahoe with the dash. Sometimes when I first start it, the dash works, then it stops working. If I beat on it, it'll come back on. Take the dash out. I got a video on taking the dash out. It's not that hard. A bunch of plastic crap snaps out. You don't really have to worry about it all that much. But those dashes were junk. A lot of them were made in China. A lot of guys will go to a junkyard and get a used one. Guys that are real fanatics, they'll pull them out, and if they see the circuit board, which is a printed circuit board, is starting to come apart, they'll re-solder them and stuff. I mean, it's a real pain in the butt. But if you want to go that far, go right ahead. It could be that the soldering's starting to come out. I mean, they're cheaply made dashes. There's no arguing that. James the First says, I start up my car, it clatters quite a bit, but then it quiets down. Mechanic said, it's the lifters. And he quoted me this outrageous price of over $1,000 to replace it. What should I do? Get some engine flush. You can go to any auto parts store. I like the K&W engine flush. It's got the directions on the can, shows you exactly how to use it. Do that, then change the oil and filter. Sometimes it's dirt in the hydraulic lifters. If that fixes it, great. Now, if it doesn't fix it, once you start it after a little while, the ticking goes away, a lot of guys will just live with it. If it runs okay, it doesn't trip any codes. Now, if eventually they get worn enough, it'll trip misfire codes, because if the lifters aren't opening and closing the valves correctly, you're going to have a poor running engine. It's going to have misfires on the ones that are bad. Then if you want it to run right, you have to replace it. But truthfully, I've had customers sometimes drive them years that way with the lifters clacking away. That stuff can just happen. Then Chong, I got a 2010 Corolla, 120,000 miles. The driver's side tie rod is seized. I can't get it out. I've tried. How can I get that thing out? Okay, when the tie rod is seized, you're going to replace it anyways, right? I mean, it's seized, you're going to replace it. So you tried beating it, hammering all that stuff. Get a good torch and heat that sucker until it glows red hot. You're throwing it away, so you don't care what happens to it. The tie rod goes into the metal arm, the place where it goes in that hole, that solid metal. Heating that up isn't going to hurt anything. So you heat it up red hot, and then it'll come out. You got the nut off of it, then just hammer the heck out of it. When it's glowing red hot, it'll pop out. Because red hot metal is softer and it'll come right out. I've done that a million times. Since you're going to buy a new one, and then if the other end won't unscrew, you do the same thing. You take the bolt off, and if the bolt won't come off, heat that up red hot till it glows and then take it off. Jerry Purdy, why would parking lights not work on an 86 Dodge truck? All the fuses are good. First thing you check is the switch. It's simple. You turn them on with the switch, and then you see there's power going into the switch and power going out of the switch to the parking lights. They aren't, replace the switch. Now, if you turn it on and power comes out of the switch and goes back, then you either have a power failure, you need power and ground in a 12-volt electrical system on cars. So, go to the parking lights. See if they're not grounded. The black wire is the ground wire. Ground it to the body of the frame. If they start working, just run a new wire. It's easy enough to do. And also check the sockets. That's what. It's an 86 Dodge truck. Sockets get corroded. You pull them out. If they're all corroded, you can go to a place like AutoZone, get aftermarket sockets and put new sockets, and you just splice the wires. And it's a very easy job to do. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.